Welcome, everyone, to Candidate Facebook Live, part of our Commitment 2020 coverage. I'm WMUR Political Director Adam Sexton, and today, this week, in our Facebook Live series, we're going to be talking to the Democratic candidates for governor of New Hampshire. And let's just jump right into it. We're going to start today, Monday, with Councillor Andrew Valinsky, Executive Councillor from District 2. Councillor, thanks for joining us today.
Hi, Adam. Thanks for having me.
All right. And as you build your questions for the councillor here, you can post them in the comment section of this post. But to get things going, let's just have you, councillor, explain a little bit about who you are and why you're running for governor.
Thanks, Adam. I'm Andrew Valinsky, running for governor. As many people know, I was the Claremont school funding lawyer. I led a team that exposed just how unfairly our schools are funded and how the quality of a child's education depends upon where she lives. I've shown that I can challenge the status quo, particularly when it comes to reducing property taxes and improving the quality of New Hampshire schools. We've convinced the Supreme Court that education is a constitutional right. That was a bold idea, but for lack of courageous leadership, we've yet to achieve the promise of Claremont. I am running for governor, number one, to achieve that promise so that seniors don't have to worry about being forced out of their homes, so that children get good educations all across our state, so that taxpayers' property taxes go down, and so that young and working class families can get into homes. So that's issue number one for me. Issue number two is climate change. We need to do better on climate change. There is no longer any excuse for one more fracked gas pipeline in New Hampshire. I worked hard with many others to defeat the Granite Bridge fracked gas pipeline. That's part of the answer, stopping the bad things. Because of my positions on education, my positions on climate change, I've been endorsed by the 17,000 member NEA New Hampshire Teachers Union, by the Sierra Club, by 350.org. I hope others will check us out. Go to valinskynh.com.
So obviously education, a big part of your advocacy leading up to your initial runs for public office there just a few years ago. Ann Goodrich Bazan has the first question. How can we fix education funding?
Well, Ann should know because she's on the school board in Winchester. Winchester's a community that had its budget overturned by a local vote to cut $1.5 million from this small, struggling community's budget. It can't take that loss. And the school board's not at fault. So we have a terrible system that puts schools and school boards in the middle. It's a structural problem. It's not the fault of the local school board. We need to start by making sure that everyone understands how the system works and how unfair it is. How is it that Mitt Romney, with his $10 million estate in Wolfboro, pays $7 in a tax rate, and in Winchester, it's three or four times that? So that's number one. Make sure people understand how it works. Reduce the property tax reliance. We're worst in the nation in property tax reliance. We need to fix that. And then everyone has to pay their own fair share. And I say there are multiple ways to get there. All of those options need to be on the table. They're the obvious ones that we've talked about for years. The problem has gotten worse and worse and worse. It's not sustainable. If we want New Hampshire to move forward, we need to have adult, mature conversations about how we fund important services like schools.
And getting down to it on those conversations in terms of how to bring in more revenue for the state of New Hampshire, you're clearly talking about a tax of some kind. Is there a way in your plan to have taxes go down for some people, not just the property taxes, but their overall tax burden? Or would we see an across the board tax burden increase for some people in the middle class?
No, I think we spend overall about the right amount on schools. The problem is we do it completely unevenly, and we make those who struggle the most pay the most. So if we even the burden, we don't really have to increase the overall funding of schools, which is about $3.2 billion. The problem is 73% of that amount comes from the local property tax. That is a broad-based tax. Let's be clear on that. Everyone pays the property tax. directly if you're a homeowner, indirectly if you rent. That broad-based tax is the most unfair way to fund, and we can do it with about the same amount of money that we have now.
You've been thinking about this for decades now. What is the best way to do it? I know you said you want a conversation, but clearly you probably have an idea of what would be the best way to do it.
Yeah, I think my role as governor is to do two things. Use the bully pulpit to force the conversation forward, to talk about the facts of how this works. I don't think any gubernatorial candidate in New Hampshire history knows as much about how our schools are funded than I do. So number one, you push the conversation forward with the bully pulpit. And number two, you act as the collaborator in chief. You give the options to the legislature, you push them to make some decisions, and then you have to live with what the legislature does. But looking the other way, acting as if there isn't a problem, is not an acceptable approach, and I wouldn't do that.
Next question comes from Louise Tilton. She asks, if you were governor right now, would you keep all students at home with distance learning?
Well, that's the question of the day, isn't it? I've been talking broadly to teachers and parents and administrators. Governor Sununu and Frank Edelblu, because they listened to Pence and DeVos, have made a complete hash of it. I thought that we could open with appropriate planning and with resources distributed to communities so that they could teach outside, so that they could improve air handling systems. None of this has happened. There's not even been renegotiations with school personnel to figure out who gets hired, who are the extra people that need to get hired, how are they paid. We are so far behind. I think unless there is an unexpected, coordinated, last-minute push, I'm afraid that the best answer is going to be that we have to stay remote until October as we watch the catastrophe of the virus. Is it spreading? Is it remaining dormant? This is something that should have been the subject of careful planning months ago, but Sununu and Edelblu gave over their responsibility to DeVos and Pence, and we are in deep trouble right now if we try to open.
Broadening out on the COVID-19 response, Melanie McDonald asks, what specific challenges does New Hampshire face beyond our immediate COVID challenges, and what plans do you have to address them?
So beyond COVID, there are multiple crises going at the same time. So we actually have the COVID pandemic public health crisis. We have an economic crisis. We have a climate change crisis. And we have a crisis of racial injustice. So let's talk about the economic for a moment, because we have touched on the pandemic part of it. We have a social safety net that is full of holes. We're last in New England in our cap on unemployment benefits. No matter what you earn, no matter how many people in your family, it's $427 a week, lowest in New England, and no additional money if you have a number of dependents. That's a problem. We don't have a minimum wage. We default to the federal, which is $7.25. Again, a huge problem. We should be at $15 minimum wage, and we should have a living wage for unemployment benefits. So we start there. We need to work on that. We need to get the property tax under control because, quite frankly, it's like a second mortgage that always goes up and you can never pay off, and it's due whether you're in an economic crisis or not. Climate change is the next crisis. I already mentioned in my opening that first we need to stop the bad things. We shouldn't be building new fossil fuel infrastructure, and politicians shouldn't be taking money from fossil fuel utilities to allow those projects to go forward. But then we need to create jobs in a new green economy. I'm a big fan of a regional Green New Deal with our nearby northern New England neighbors. We need to do some things together to boost the economy, to invest in the economy. You know, New Hampshire is last in New England in its investment in solar. We get 1% of our electricity from solar power. Vermont, our neighbor, gets 12%. That's Chris Sununu's doing with putting caps on net metering, with reducing incentives to go with solar and other kinds of alternative energy. Let me mention racial injustice. I disagree with Sununu. Systemic racism does exist in New Hampshire, and we need to deal with it. And I hope we have an opportunity in some of the later questions to follow up and talk more about how to deal with it.
We have a question coming in from Marianne Howard, steering back to the COVID response in schools. How are you going to handle kids with special needs if they have to homeschool again?
You know, another huge dilemma that we're figuring out at the last minute. So a number of the special educators, therapists, people who work one-on-one with children who receive occupational therapy services, for example, are working to train parents so that with the therapist's guidance, the parents can actually provide the actual hands-on work with the student. A lot of it's done with Zoom, a lot of it's done with talking the parents through it. That's part of this. I think part of it is we're going to need to have facilities where we can bring special ed kids into a school under very careful circumstances to work directly with a professional and a paraprofessional. Some of the services are just too important to go without. But that's not filling a school by any means. That's not coming close to 50% density. That's a handful of kids who need special services coming in and getting those services. And let me add, so that this isn't a resource issue, the state needs to step up and provide resources so this can happen, so that Claremont doesn't fall behind in providing services to its special education students while neighboring communities are able to do it. The state needs to step up. This really underscores the need for the state to be a prominent player when it comes to fairly funding schools. Sorry, Adam.
Yeah, no problem. Let's drill down there for a second, though. Obviously, you know, you think about a school district like Nashua, where so many kids are facing not the same level of opportunity as perhaps wealthier school districts around the state. If they can't go back to school, you've got to figure there are a lot of those kids who might be, you know, even though there is risk in going back to school, they're facing a tremendous risk in staying at home if they can't get the education they need to move forward. How do you deal with that aspect of the dilemma?
Yeah, it's a tragedy. You know, Nashua is the second lowest spending school district in the state. The lowest is Manchester. They also happen to be the two most diverse districts in our state, which tells you something about the systemic racism issue. I think you're going to need to do remote learning in a way that takes into account the fact that some kids don't have a lot of support at home for learning or for supervision, that kids will need to have some kind of contact. But you can only do this in the framework of what's happening in your community with respect to COVID. So we had a forum last Wednesday night, 150 people on the Zoom meeting with me, talking about how to reopen safely. We had educators, we had some public health folks, and the biggest takeaway is what's happening in your community. Schools will exacerbate whatever it is. If things are going really well and you're really smart about how you open in a limited, lower density way, then you can improve things. But if you're in a community where COVID is on the rise, and you don't open with lower density, plenty of resources, things of that nature, teaching outside, none of that is going to improve, and a lot of it's going to make your community situation worse. Can I add one thing about this? We keep talking about reopening and the dangerous exposure that we're going to expose school personnel to. There are workers' comp systems in our state, particularly for firefighters, where certain kinds of illnesses that are endemic to their work are presumed to result from the work. So they don't have to go and prove their case over and over again. We need to do the same thing with school personnel. Governor Sununu should immediately adopt an emergency order that presumes that any working school personnel who contracts COVID has done so through work and is entitled to workers' comp or, God forbid, the death benefits that go with it.
Next question comes from Maria Smith Lopez. She asks, what do you see as the biggest issue facing campaign finance?
Biggest issue regarding campaign finance is there are too many ways to circumvent the system. There are too many ways to cheat. You really have to depend on your candidates to be transparent and not to circumvent the system. And we need to reduce those loopholes. So let me give you an example. The Secretary of State has a campaign finance reporting system where candidates show how much they've raised and from whom and how they've spent the money. My campaign, actually all my campaigns, from executive council to the current one, we've always filed digitally, which means all of our filings are completely searchable. Anyone can go on and look for a name and search through the whole file. My opponent in the primary and Chris Sununu don't use the digital facility. I think my opponent decided to use it at this last filing. They file by facsimile so that it's not searchable. So that's number one. You need to improve transparency. There's the LLC loophole that allows big time real estate developers to use each of the LLC companies that they own to account for a new maximum contribution limit. So 7,000 is the limit for a human being. An LLC under state law has that same limit. If you own 10 LLCs, you have a limit of $70,000. Chris Sununu is a master at violating the intent of the law by using the LLC loophole. But my opponent in the Democratic primary did the same thing with his treasurer, who happens to be a real estate developer, and was running ads saying he didn't do it. When he got caught, he had to return over $10,000. I'm endorsed by Ben and Jerry, Granny D's family, because of my campaign finance positions. And Ben and Jerry have named an ice cream after me. It's called Valinsky's Courageous Crunch. Because of my positions on campaign finance. My kids think that's the coolest thing I've accomplished in this race.
And to tie two issues together here, do you believe that the Granite Bridge project, that the support for that was influenced among Democrats by campaign contributions?
Well, I'll let people speak for themselves. But here's the thing. I got the same briefing that my opponent, Dan Feltes, and that Governor Sununu received. I left the briefing thinking, this makes no sense. It's a fracked gas, $400 million boondoggle by a company that's never built a pipeline before. Why would we do this? Sununu and Feltes both left with checks. Feltes has received more than $1,700. I'll let people draw their own conclusions, but the Granite Bridge project really has become a case study in judgment. I opposed it from the start because it's a danger to the climate, because it's based on increasing the fracked gas we use in the state. And two, it would have stuck the ratepayers with a $400 million bill that would have taken them 20 or 30 years to pay off, which commits us to the wrong kind of fuel for that long. Now that they've pulled the project, they want to be reimbursed for their $9 million sunk costs. I don't think they were prudent in going forward with this project, and I would not support reimbursing Liberty Utilities for that $9 million.
Seeing some comments coming in here basically around the topic of the opioid crisis. What would be the plan of a Valinsky administration to do anything differently, or how would you address this ongoing opioid crisis that's still here with us even amid the pandemic?
Well, that's part of the problem, isn't it, Adam, that the pandemic is so close on in our face that we forget about some of the other crises that we're dealing with. So I've been on the executive council. I've sat with the governor. I was there when the governor said that he invented the hub and spoke model for treating people with substance abuse disorder resulting from opioids. I heard him say that, and then I went to Vermont, where they had the hub and spoke process 5 years earlier than us. And I talked with leaders there, and they told me, you can basically stand up the hubs pretty easily. You usually build them around a hospital. The problem is the spokes. We don't have enough providers in our communities who can provide treatment and supervision, depending on a continuum of care, all the way from peer to medically assisted. There aren't enough spokes, enough providers. Part of that is because we pay so little in New Hampshire for Medicaid reimbursement. So one of the places I would start is enhancing Medicaid reimbursement for certain kinds of providers who provide services related to substance abuse disorder. I would build out the entirety of the continuum of care from peer review to medically assisted. I would support further the community health centers because they should be the backbone of primary and preventative care, and we can work through including them and the community mental health centers in the treatment protocols. We have parts of our state that are really underserved when it comes to mental health and physical health, and we need to build that backbone.
Circling back to the energy / climate change topic here, Charles Hutchins Jr. says, finish the nuclear power plant. What's your position on that? Would nuclear power be an acceptable alternative to try and reduce some of the carbon emissions here in New Hampshire?
Yeah, no one's doing that anywhere in the country, and it doesn't make sense. We have alternative energy, we have conservation, we can do a lot more with both of those.
Somebody else is, oh, this is Charles again, what about hydroelectric?
It depends. So hydroelectric in and for New Hampshire can make good sense, but hydroelectric that comes from Canada defiles our forests and mountains and just gets pumped down to the Boston market, which was the Northern Pass project, doesn't make sense. That's why I was one of the lawyers in the Supreme Court opposing Northern Pass. Chris Sununu, Dan Feltes both supported that project. It didn't make any sense. I actually went to Stewartstown and walked and drove part of the route that the transmission lines would take coming down from Canada. They were really going to take down mountaintops, and it makes no sense for us to be the pass-through. If you're talking about local hydro, that makes a lot more sense.
Another question from Maria Smith Lopez. She asks, what would you do for young people here in New Hampshire?
Oh, God. We really haven't stepped up for you guys, and we need to do a lot better. So first, climate change. You're the future. We have a responsibility to make it a livable future. Second, property taxes and fair funding of K to 12 schools. Every child who grows up in New Hampshire should have an opportunity for a quality education. That's an economic justice issue. You know, the difference in earnings between a high school dropout, a high school graduate, and a college graduate is millions of dollars. And we should give everyone that opportunity. New Hampshire is worst in the nation in K-12 education funding. We're also worst in community college and in college and university tuition support. That's why New Hampshire has among the highest student debt loads in the nation, around $37,000 per student. We need to do a lot better in supporting community college and university. If you're near the seacoast, and go to a New Hampshire community college, your tuition's $7,600. If you cross the border into Maine, your tuition's $2,800, one-third as much. That's not right. We can do a lot better with that. We ought to make community college as close to free as possible. We should start by incentivizing particular career paths in nursing, in mental health, in early childhood development. Some of those folks are the most important people we'll encounter in our lives, yet we pay them the least and we make them first go into debt to get the appropriate educational background. That shouldn't happen in our state, and I would start there with incentivizing certain careers with free community college tuition.
And speaking of youth and power right now, the Black Lives Matter movement has been a major uprising, not just across the country, but here in New Hampshire as well. This has been something that's been a little fraught for you because they were calling you to account based on some comments you made at an executive council meeting about a nomination. You said a nominee was an example of tokenism. Explain what the learning process has been for you here in trying to people know you as a progressive activist, and what had happened earlier in June was kind of at odds with that. So describe how this process has worked for you.
I've been a progressive activist all my life. I have worked closely with the national NAACP. I helped to end profiling in Manchester as counsel for the ACLU in New Hampshire. I've done death penalty defense work throughout my whole career. Throughout the South, I was a public defender in New Hampshire. Here's the learning process. The Black Lives Matters group put out a demand of 7 issues, I think it was. I read them. I quickly and wholeheartedly endorsed those demands. They made a lot of sense to me. And then I took a little bit of time and said, you know, you really haven't gone far enough. We need to work harder in a number of areas that I've been, quite frankly, focused on for my entire professional career. So education, as we've talked about, the 2 most diverse school districts in our state spend the least on their kids, by thousands of dollars below the average. We need to improve the funding there, but we need to do more than just improve funding. We need to work on the curricula that are in place, and we need to recruit Black and brown teachers to help teach that curriculum that is more diverse for our students. We need to focus on law enforcement. We need to demilitarize law enforcement. We need to also diversify law enforcement. Our new police officers, and then periodically through their careers, need to go through implicit bias training. I went through it in 2017. It made a big impact on me. And I think police officers would benefit from that. Healthcare, as we've mentioned, doesn't exist in a good way in all parts of our state. Black and brown people often suffer disproportionately poorer outcomes, even with COVID-19. That shouldn't exist anywhere. So it's all evidence of systemic racism. And then in the early question I was asked about safety nets and income inequality. A lot of that applies to Black and brown people who are working, in particular in the service industry in our state. We need to do living minimum wage, livable minimum wage. We need to make health care more affordable and better available. We need to deal with the unemployment cap in our state. So there's a lot that we need to do.
Dylan Tyler Curry says, let's talk marijuana prohibition. Where do you stand on recreational cannabis?
Legalize it for adult use. Put the bill on my desk. I'll sign it with the normal safeguards. Moreover, I would use it as an income generator for the state. It won't be large, but there will be some income that comes from it. I would not put all kinds of precautions on in place. The typical ones that you would expect make a lot of sense. But here's the thing. We talk about marijuana being decriminalized in New Hampshire. If you're between 18 and 21 and you possess marijuana, that's a misdemeanor. That's a misdemeanor that goes on your record. We need to expunge all of those records. People who've been convicted of marijuana possession need to have their records expunged without cost, expeditiously through the court system. So legalize, expunge, tax it.
Sneak in one last quick follow-up question here before we hit the 30-minute mark. What about the tax framework on cannabis? We see states like California have almost created another black market just based on the fact that some of the tax is so high that it still incentivizes that. So is there a right size, I guess, for the tax burden on cannabis production?
Well, there's a right approach. So you can't say you're for legalization and then tax it so highly that it's unproductive to produce marijuana for sale in your state. That's a backhanded way of keeping marijuana illegal and encouraging the black market. I wouldn't do that. It needs to be set at a level that allows the marijuana to be sold in our state to really make it legal and not prohibitively expensive, and that'll help undermine the black market. And we can't do this with these marijuana entrepreneurs. There are communities that have been disadvantaged because of marijuana laws, and we need to respect that we owe a bit of a debt there to make that right.
All right, Councillor Andrew Walensky, Democratic candidate for governor, thanks for joining us for Facebook Live here on our Facebook page. We appreciate your time.
Thanks, Adam. Good to be with you. Thanks,
likewise,
everyone.
All right. And we will be back on Wednesday with the other candidate in this Democratic race for governor, Dan Feltes. We hope you join us then. Until then, have a great week.